and welcome to The Culture Show. Our special guests today are Cathy O'Donnell and Joe Culby, and we're delighted to have Mr. Michael McGinty on double bass with us today as well. You're very welcome, Michael. And we're going to start now with a brilliant Coldplay song called The Scientist. Come up to meet you, tell you I'm sorry. You don't know how lovely you are. I had to find you, tell you I need you, tell you I set you apart. Tell me your secrets and ask me your questions. Oh, let's go back to the start. Running in circles, coming up tails, heads on a science apart. Nobody said it was easy. It's such a shame for us to part. Nobody said it was easy. No one ever said it would be this hard. Oh, take me back to the start. I was just guessing at numbers and figures, pulling the puzzles apart. Questions of science, science and progress, don't speak as loud as my heart. But tell me you love me, come back and haunt me. Oh, and I rush to the start. Running in circles, chasing our tails, coming back as we are. Nobody said it was easy. Oh, it's such a shame for us to part. Nobody said it was easy. No one ever said it would be so hard. I'm going back to the start. Shame for us to part. Nobody said it was easy. No one ever said it would be so hard. I'm going back to the start. Coldplay song, The Scientist. And our next lovely song is Isn't She Lovely? Of course, made famous by Stevie Wonder. Who are we going to dedicate this to, Bob? Dedicated to Paul. Isn't she lovely? Through love would be making one as lovely as she? But isn't she lovely, made from love? Isn't she pretty? Especially for our lovely Paul Maguire, dedicated from the lovely Bob Quick. We're going to cross now to Andrew Maguire, who's talking to the equally lovely Cathy O'Donnell.
Hello, I'm here with Cathy O'Donnell. Cathy is a member of the Open Door Poetry Group here in Oma, a local writing group in which its members support each other in their reading and writing pursuits. I'm here to talk to Cathy about three books and three writers that have inspired her in her own writing journey, and to discuss her own writing in a bit more detail. Cathy, it's great to have you with
nice
us.
Nice to be here.
Thanks very much for being here. I understand that when you first got into poetry, one of the writers that really inspired you, or one of the writers that you loved to read, was Sylvia Plath.
Indeed, tell us
a wee bit about your relationship with her work.
Well, her work is so searingly honest, and she articulates pain, you know, like no other, as far as I'm concerned. But then that's just my opinion. Mm-hmm. And she was writing at a time when women were not really recognised as poets. And, of course, she was married to the poet Ted Hughes. And I suppose she spent a lot of her life, her writing life, promoting his work. They had a very passionate, blazing, passionate relationship, which, of course, burnt out. And unfortunately, she did have some mental health problems, and she found life unbearable at a point, and so she took her own life. But it's just the honesty of her poetry.
Do you remember a time when you first encountered her work, or what stage of your life would that have been, and how did it, was it about it that really had such a profound impact on you?
I suppose it was in my late teens. And really, she was saying things that I had never read before, and in a way that I had never encountered. So I just I've been reading and reading her for years, and I read her biographies, and she's just one of many poets, of course, that I do love.
And because she's such an influential figure and the influence her writing has had, do you think she's one of those writers that when you read now, you can see the impact she's had on poets since and the impact she's had on, you know, contemporary British poetry?
Absolutely, especially on women. Mm-hmm. So she's a very important figure in the literary world.
And sort of, if we talked a bit more generally about, you know, the role of poetry in your life, how, you know, soon when you started reading poetry, maybe in your teens, was it something that you instantly gravitated towards?
And probably even before that, mm-hmm. even in primary school, just learning the poems, the Irish poems, like Up the Hairy Mountain, Down the Rushy Glen, you know, all that. All the Yeats poetry, and it always was like music, it sang, and it touched something deep inside you.
Did writing your own poetry always go hand in hand with that, or was that something that came
later?
That took a bit
more time to develop, you know.
And then what could you tell us about that journey? I mean, is it sort of a daunting thing for anybody that has a passion for poetry and reading poetry to then pick up the pen and start attempting it?
Yes, I suppose when you start, you just sort of pour everything onto the page and you think it's wonderful. And it's only later. And you look at it and you think, oh my God. And gradually you begin to sort of critically look at your own work and realise that you've a lot to learn. And of course, learn from each other. Mm-hmm. And that's where the writing group really helps.
Great. Well, we'll get back to poetry in a bit, but there's also mm-hmm. other books that you discussed today that have had an impact on you. Another one is If This Is a Man.
If This Is a Man.
Which was something a bit different. Tell us a bit about
book. Yes. That's a book about a man in the concentration camp, a young man, 24 years of age. But it's not about the cruelty as such. It's about the relationships of other prisoners in the camp. And it's the everyday, day-to-day, terrible stress of not knowing, are you going to be alive tomorrow? And, you know, how the mind is totally concentrated on the food, which is so awful, just the bread, a bit of bread and watery soup, and then the hard, hard physical work. So the way he writes also is not in any self-pitying kind of way. It's absolutely straightforward. And I've read that book. I'm reading it again, actually, for probably the fourth time.
Yeah, I think it's one of those books that's renowned for the sort of incredible juxtaposition between the horrors of what it's talking about and then the sort of not the simplicity of the prose, but the sort of the clarity of it. And
the clarity of it,
the way
right.
that, as you say, that even in this unimaginable situation, uh-huh. there's still the focus on the small everyday things. I mean, it sort of tackles such a huge issue. Is that something in your reading you've always looked to for, like, maybe an understanding of what is unimaginable? Literature can sometimes give us an insight into those things.
Yes, and it also makes you realise that no matter how hard your own life can be from time to time, when you read about people who've transcended that and come out of it, and so you realise, you know, keep going on and you will survive. I suppose that's the crux of that story.
The other writer we're going to discuss is one that maybe some of our viewers will be well acquainted with, uh-huh. Edna O'Brien.
Yes.
Now, I know you haven't chosen one book in particular, which I imagine perhaps says it all, is her sort of body of work.
Her body of work.
Is very meaningful to you.
Indeed. And everyone probably knows the early books, like The Country Girls mm-hmm. and The Girl with Green Eyes. But her short stories are amazing. You know, Saints and Sinners is a collection of short stories. And Mother Ireland is a collection of short stories from Edna O'Brien. And they're all wonderfully well written.
Mm-hmm. And obviously her work has been, you know, at the forefront, really, various literature for a number of decades now. Is she a writer that you've been reading sort of as her careers went along? When did you first encounter her work?
Again, it probably would have been in my teens, late teens, maybe. And of course, she was writing about emotion and sex and mm-hmm. young girls, and everybody, you could identify so well with it, and yet nobody else was writing mm-hmm. like that in Ireland, like. And of course she was banned, as you know. Mm-hmm. But I mean, her work is as relevant, I suppose, too. It's like the other two writers.
I wonder, is there something special for you as a reader having, I mean, a relationship with a writer is very different whenever you're able to almost grow with them and the works come along? Because obviously a lot of the great literature we encounter is, you know, written, could be written 100 years ago, written by deceased writers or whatnot. Mm-hmm. But there's also something nice about being able to read a writer and knowing that more work's coming and being able to follow their journey.
Yes.
Do you feel that...
Absolutely.
Has Edna O'Brien and her work felt like a significant thing in your life throughout because of that?
Yes, it has, I suppose, yes. She's just one among many, of course, but I mean, she's in her 90s and she's still writing. And she speaks wonderfully when she's been interviewed. You know, she's as good, she expresses herself so wonderfully.
Anna Still, as you
Anna
said,
Still in her
prominent,
90s.
Yeah,
she's
one of them was
still full
one
of life,
her
yeah.
prominent literary figures.
Yes.
It's great to have you here to talk about the Open Door Poetry Group. For anyone mm-hmm. that doesn't know about it, give us an insight into how it came about.
Well, I think, as far as I remember, it actually came about when somebody put, I think it was Michael Heaney, saw an advert or put up an advert for just writers or people who love to read and write to meet up in Broderick's, and that's all those years ago, over 20 years ago. And so one evening we began, people came in just and introduced themselves, and to be honest, it's gone since. We've been in different venues, we don't meet there anymore, but and the core membership is still there. And of course, we're always hoping that new people will join.
And I mean, you mentioned earlier about the when you start writing and then the sort of how you have to assess your own work and how difficult that is. So tell us about how integral that sort of support network is for anyone that's for any creative endeavor, really.
I think it's extremely important. I know some people write and maybe just put it away in a drawer and don't want anyone else to see it, and that's okay too. But when you come into a group, well, I suppose there's that fellowship and that interest, and it is hard critiquing someone else's work and that, and we're not in any way brutal or cruel. Yeah. But it's insightful. Someone else reading something you've written can pick up on something you hadn't even thought mm-hmm. about or intended. And I find it very valuable.
And then I suppose, and then there's also, it must be very rewarding for you as a member when you see somebody come in with a piece of work and, you know, you get to discuss it and look at it and you can see it improve and you can see the person improve the work.
It must
be very rewarding.
It's so wonderful when somebody new comes in with new work. You know, that just revitalizes everybody.
And there's obviously, I mean, it's led to plenty of success. I know you have, I believe, published an anthology of combined work, and
yes.
several members have, including yourself, I believe, have published your own pieces. Tell us a bit more about some of them.
Well, a very interesting thing did happen. Paddy Montague, one of our members, he was in touch with a very elderly man in a nursing home who had been a writer all his life. he was an ex-policeman, but he always wrote. He was always wanted to be a poet, counted as a poet. And he had masses and masses of work in a wardrobe, boxes and boxes and boxes. And so we decided that we would take some of the work and look through it and maybe select and maybe try and get it published. And we did accomplish that. So that was wonderful. Mm-hmm. His name is James McBride.
Brilliant.
It's called Off the Beaten Track.
Yeah. So, I suppose, finally, is there anyone that wants to find out, because as you say, you're always looking for new members, and
uh-huh.
so if anyone that does want to find out more about the Open Door Group, where is it, who can they contact, or what's the best starting point for them?
Well, myself, or Paddy Montague, or Femi, or Amber,
mm-hmm.
you know.
And these are available, I think, the group
be
is
the
on
best place.
Facebook.
I think we do.
The group
oh,
is
yes,
on Facebook
is,
to contact through
is,
that,
yes,
and as
indeed.
You say, I'm sure you're always on the lookout.
We're always on the lookout for new members.
Brilliant. Well, Cathy, thank you very much.
Can I plug my own book?
Please do, yeah.
So it's called No Ribbons, No Bows, and I think it's in Top News, and that's the only place, really. That's that.
Okay. Brilliant, brilliant. Cathy, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you very much.
Dimension, it was, wasn't it? Yeah. Something I've always actually fancied doing, hot air ballooning. Definitely not. Hot air ballooning, I think, especially on a day like this that we're recording, beautiful blue skies overlooking the Struil River from the Struil Arts Centre. It's all gorgeous. But it's not all. But another favourite of mine, although I was going to say it's not all about me, but this is one of my favourite songs. Send in the clowns. Isn't it rich? Are we a pair? Me here at last. On the ground, you in midair, send in the clowns. Isn't it bliss? Don't you approve? One who keeps tearing. The clowns, send in the clowns. just when I stopped opening doors, finally knowing the one that I wanted was yours, making my entrance again with my usual sure of my lines, no one is there. Don't you love farce? My fault, I fear. I thought that you'd want what I want. Sorry, my dear, but where are the clowns? Send in the clowns. Isn't it rich? Isn't it queer? Losing my time in this late in my career. Where are the clowns? There ought to be clowns. Well, maybe.
Beautiful song from A Little Night Music, isn't that right, Kurt Weill? Oh, and the doctor also speaks German. Mind you, there was a great joke there to be had. I hope you appreciate the fact that I didn't make it as in send in the clowns. The boys are going to play an instrumental now called Blues Walk.
Thank you.
This is a very special introduction to our next guest, who is the one and only local man, Joe Culby, been introduced by this instrumental called Killer Joe. Joe Culby, you're very welcome to the Culture Show.
Thank you, Gerda.
Drummer,
yes.
Singer, guitarist, composer,
mm-hmm.
And you've been out of the picture for a while.
I have. A lot of people thought I had died. I've been off the scene. The last time I done something kind of with Bob and the boys was. It's 2012, was it?
I think so, yeah. In Main Street, in the... Yeah.
2012, and we've done a gig. We've done two gigs for Mickey McElroy down in Main Street,
mm-hmm.
with the Jump the Queue, the big band. And I had the most horrendous experience of my life. And I suppose we can go into that. It was kind of the end of something that had been brewing for a long, long time, probably since I started playing and performing. And basically, I suppose people now would call it panic attacks, but it was worse than that. It was awful. And as soon as I kind of hit the stage, well, maybe about 5 minutes, I've always had this thing where the 5 minutes before I go on, it's like everything leaves me. You know, my confidence leaves me. I just doubt, this awful, awful self-doubt will come over me. And for 5 minutes, I could go home. I could just leave the gig and go home. And so I have to stay there. And the first two people that I ever heard or I'd identifying with was actually Robbie Williams and Peter Kay.
Okay.
They both said that that 5 minutes when you're waiting on the wings, you kind of say, I wonder, is he going to turn up tonight? And somebody asked, well, what do you mean by that? I said, well, the guy that does that.
The performer.
Because the guy, well, for me anyway, the guy that walks along the street, the guy sitting here now,
mm-hmm.
is not the boy that sings. And that's, I suppose, like an alter ego type thing.
Yeah.
But the self-doubt and no confidence in that just would wash over me. And I was always able to control it. And, you know, in 5 minutes' time, once I hit the stage, get the first line of the first song over me, I'll be flying.
Yeah.
You know? And I've been around the music game and, you know, learned stuff as a drummer, then learned stuff as a guitar player and a singer. I have enough tricks that I can get through a gig, no matter what kind of happens. But that all left me and it never came back. So the first gig that we done was, it was awful. It was just awful. And I think actually Michael was playing and he was recording this and no one knew what was going on.
I was going to say, for anyone who's there or anyone who has ever seen you perform,
mm-hmm.
you know, you are the showman.
You are the one jumping around on
no
stage.
No show like a Joe show.
Yeah, love it.
Yeah.
And to hear that this turmoil was and is all going on in your head.
But I've always had that. I've always had where performing was, it was tough. It was being someone that I wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it goes back to my whole reasons for doing it and getting into it were wrong from the start.
Okay.
And so.
And what were they? Well, you know, was it the company that you were keeping, and you were surrounded by musical people, and it's just where the road led you?
Yeah. Well, I come from on my mother's side, very musical family, the McGlynns and the Kearneys.
Yeah.
You know, Artie McGlynn was an uncle of mine. So there's a big high standard of kind of performing and talent there.
So an expectation.
So there's an expectation there. So and I watched the likes of Artie and all our uncles and playing, and I thought, if I do that, that gets you a kind of a recognition and a worth, mm-hmm. or you know, I thought, right, I'll do that.
Yeah.
And I realized that I had some kind of natural talent. It was drumming first,
mm-hmm.
and then that changed, and I became, a singer and a guitar player. But my reasons for, I get mixed up with, this sounds very philosophical and stuff like that there, but I get mixed up with what I do with who I am.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that...
That's not an uncommon thing, Joe.
No. The thing was, Bob, I didn't know who I was, you know, and if you have no real grounding and who you are, and you have no kind of identity, so you pick something that will give you an identity, or give you a worth.
Yeah.
It's like we were talking before, you know, people used to would have looked at me and said, he's got it made, you know, he's a singer and he can do this and he can do that. And there's a certain amount of notoriety and, he's this. If people knew the lack of self-worth that I had from the first gig I done to the very last one,
mm-hmm.
and the reason I stopped playing was the last two gigs were just hell.
Bob, were you aware, because you were playing in Jump the Queue as well.
The section of that, I wouldn't have been aware of that, mm-hmm. I have to say. And when Joe said they were horrendous, he sang very well, the gigs were great. But you mean your experience?
My experience
was horrendous.
Was horrendous.
Yeah.
You know, to the point where when I went home, the first one I thought, well, maybe it'll not happen again.
Mm.
But certainly when I'd done the second one, it was worse than the first one.
You used the word torture.
Torture.
When we were chatting before. And that's a strong word.
Mm.
And as I say, people who were at the gig, who would have been at the gig and watching you perform,
would have known.
Further, I mean, I think that I know that this will surprise, your absolute honesty with all of this will surprise a lot of people.
It was, and he didn't, I think I told Danny McCormick, who was playing bass, in the second gig, I was actually outside getting sick.
My God.
And I suppose that's another thing, a part of my thing is that, I suppose if I'm going to open up, I might as well open up.
Mm-hmm.
I suffered from bulimia. And that was a way that I would cope with a lot of the nerves. When I was younger, I used to use drinking drugs.
Right.
I'm a recovering alcoholic as well. And the early days, drink was the thing.
Yeah.
But I haven't had a drink in 35 years.
That's amazing.
Or a drug.
That's amazing.
And
well done you.
There's an old story when an alcoholic, or when a heavy drinker stops drinking, his problems are over, but when an alcoholic stops drinking, his problems are only starting. And that's my experience.
Because you're drinking to forget.
I had to learn, you know, like I was drinking to forget how bad I felt. And now, this is not a real sad sob story about how rough my childhood was or nothing like that. This is just me saying, look, I was never happy. I was never content. I was never, I always felt that I could never fit in. So how do you fit in? You become something you're not. So I became a clown. I could make everybody laugh, you know, and stuff like that there. But inside, I was eaten up from the moment I woke up to the moment I went to sleep. Living was just a torture, complete and utter torture. The only escape that I got at the start was performing. Everything worked at the start. Drink worked for at the start. Drugs.
Yeah, and did drink give you the confidence to perform?
No, I kind of always, I could do it. I could bluff my way and do it. Drink actually made me more self-conscious in a way.
Okay.
It didn't do what it was doing for other people. Mm. You know what I mean? Made it give them more confidence. It actually rocked my confidence because I was out of control. I'm a control freak. So I have to be, you know.
Is that where the bulimia comes in then as well?
Oh,
but that was something that you could control.
Oh, yeah.
Because they say with people who are bulimia, anorexic, self-harm, that's the one thing you can control. Therefore, to be a control freak and want to.
And the thing is that you actually can't control it. It's like the drinking and the drugging. You think you can control it or any addiction. And like the greatest definition that I heard of any addiction was a false sense of separation from God, self, and others.
Okay.
So if you're separated from yourself and you're separated from others and you're separated from whatever your concept of God or you know, whatever created is,
yeah.
If you're separated from that, then you're in trouble. And it's a very lonely place. Life is a very lonely place. So you'll take anything that'll make it less lonely.
Yeah, get a
crutch. So I tried everything, you know what I mean? It's like chronic people pleasing, drink, drugs, sex, food, chocolate, buying clothes, buying cars, work. You know, that's where my worth was coming because I had literally nothing to say.
Yet when you were on your own, that worth meant nothing.
Nothing.
Nothing to you.
If you want to torture me when I was growing up and for a long time, you know, and I can still fall into that thing.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to torture me, put me in a room with my own head. You know, and you know, at a very early age, my head was really out to get me. It's like my head's a very, very bad neighbourhood. Don't go in there on your own.
Okay.
You know what it is? It really is.
Warning.
That's right. You know, don't go in there.
Yeah.
So I had, and then, like at 12 and 13, or even earlier, I had. That's when I discovered bulimia, or it discovered me, whatever. But also I had the compulsion to commit suicide. So
from such a young age.
So where does that come from? You know, your mother and father doesn't sit you down and say, well, here's what we're going to teach you. You're going to be bulimic. You're going to
want
to self-harm. You're going to become an alcoholic. You're going to become a drug addict. And everything that goes along with it.
Obsessive personality.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, one's too many and a thousand's not enough of anything. Sweets. You know, crisps, you know, the Pringles, you know, you want to see a disappearing act, put a box of Pringles down in front of me, gone, and you're not getting any.
Okay.
You know, that's the way, that's just, but it's that no control.
Yeah.
And yet want to control everything.
And this obviously helped you, these crutches obviously helped you through until, and when I say helped, I mean, in terms of the outer vision that we seen and the person that we would have experienced.
Music and performing became a crutch. Just another crutch.
Yeah. Until 2012.
Yeah.
When
and like the rest of them, like all the other crutches, it stopped working. And and once a crutch turns on you, it's like an Alsatian dog. It goes from protecting you to wanting to destroy you.
Yeah.
And is that because music is, in that situation, it's a crutch for you rather than something that you enjoy doing? It becomes a wrong thing, in other words.
It
becomes a destructive. And for the two of you, do you think, is singing, is that a more vulnerable thing? Then you see, if I've got a trombone in front of me, mm-hmm. I've got a trombone which I lean on. Paul Maguire's got a guitar that he plays. Yeah. Now I've got the drums. A singer is,
I think, very vulnerable.
Yeah.
I from my own experience, I have a music stand in front of me most of the time, and if I don't have a music stand in front of me, mm. I'll generally be holding a book, you know, a folder.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. On occasions, I've been holding a folder with nothing inside it.
Yeah.
But that's sort of my wee bit of protection, and I absolutely love performing.
Mm. Yeah.
But it's just, it's your instrument mm. is you. It's yes. inside
yeah,
of
yeah.
you.
Yeah.
And you know, I imagine that your crutches with the dancing and the mm. joking and the
yeah.
leaping about
yeah.
on stage.
Well, I something that I learned from Speedy Hamilton.
Mm-hmm.
Speedy, it's funny, Speedy and Artie taught me more about performing than anybody. And but Speedy says, if you stand still, you're going to fall over. With nerves.
Yep.
And so Speedy says, move. Just mm-hmm. move,
yeah.
you know, and it's yeah. so it's a nervous thing, and hit the ground running, hit the stage running.
Yeah.
That was my motto.
Okay.
And the guitar was my crutch.
Look, yes.
I'm never going to be a great guitar player. I'm never going to be another Hardy. But it was something. It was me, you know.
Yeah. And it was between you and them.
Yeah, but then, like, I remember Speedy saying, "Throw the guitar away, throw it away, and get out there and do it. If you're going to do it, do it."
Mm-hmm.
So there was that. There was that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Joe, I have to say this because this really impacted on me when we were chatting the other day, when you had been saying about getting to 2012, the gigs with Jump the Queue was the point where you thought, right,
also
I need
over,
to,
yeah.
to reassess. And you said, problems are buried alive, but they have to have their day.
Yeah.
I have never heard that before,
mm.
and that has not gone out of my head.
Yeah.
Because it's so strongly true,
yeah.
and we push down and we push down, and I have never thought of them. They're still alive, and
yeah.
they still need to be released and dealt with.
Mm.
So in the last 10 years, how have you gone about being able to present yourself here today? You're going to be singing for
yeah.
us today as well.
Well, I kind of, that was the start of, Mommy and Daddy had died. So I was on my own. And I had a lot of time, and I was getting more and more, what's the point? What's the point?
Because
I was doing nothing, and mentally I was getting worse. And physically, I've got a bad back, and it was getting worse.
And I suppose you had time.
Time.
Mum
and
Dad were gone.
I went into my head.
Okay.
Which again wasn't a good place.
Yeah.
And I was kind of I've always been in and out of therapy and stuff like that there. But I was skirting around stuff. I was really skirting around stuff, and I didn't want to look at stuff. And there's also the Irish kind of thing. Oh, we don't do feelings. Irish men, we don't do feelings.
Yeah.
You know, don't, you know, be quiet and be good. Don't
yeah.
be crying and all that there. Well, I was just a mess of emotions from, I was a wee boy. I was, you know, sensitive and felt out of place, you know what I mean? And so this was coming up. And I was pushing it down. You see, you can't drink your problems away. You can't eat your problems away. You can't buy clothes. This stuff will have its day.
Yeah.
Now, and you can run from it. You can run from it. If you run from it, your life will be, I wouldn't say not, you will be denying yourself
mm-hmm.
the real life that we're here for. And I kept pushing it away and pushing it away. And I was in and out of therapy and different things and relationships and stuff like this,
mm-hmm.
and it was just getting, it was going nowhere fast.
Yeah.
And I've always suffered from depression anyway, but about 2.5 years ago I was sitting in the kitchen in the dark on my own with a bread knife at my wrist.
My God.
And I thought, you know, just better out of here. you know, and it was, there was, you know, people, it's quite scary when you're in that situation, because people think, oh, you must be terrified. I was the most peace I'd ever had in 10 years.
Control again.
Because I thought, you know, how long does it take you to bleed out? You know, I'll be, you know, I was imagining all this, the life bleeding out of me. I'll be over. 10, 15 minutes will be over. You know, I wasn't thinking of my brother and my niece and my nephew who are my life. And wasn't thinking any of that stuff. I just was in so much pain, so much mental and emotional and spiritual pain that I thought this is. And someone came in to the house, luckily enough, and broke down, and they seen the state of me, and they said, look, you're really not well, Joe, you're just not well. And I went to the doctor, and the doctor looked at me, and because I'd been to the doctor before, and I'd been prescribed medication, but I never took it. You know, real men don't take antidepressants, Bob.
Making the move, I would imagine people, you know, close to you would have been saying, listen, you need to go and get some help. And to please them, here's the people pleaser again, to please them, you went to the doctor, got prescribed medicine, but then didn't take the medicine.
Well, I never really told anybody how bad it was.
Okay.
Especially my family. My brother might have known bits and pieces, but majority of people never knew. Like, this is going to be a wild shock to a lot of people.
I think it's going to be a huge shock.
You know, that I...
It's a huge shock to me.
That I lived this kind of dark, painful life, hidden with the persona of Joe Culby, the singer. We'll go to the gig, Joe's a good laugh. Being Joe Culby is not, I'm only finding out who he is now, really, to be honest, by saying, well, look, this is the way I've been since I was 4 or 5 years of age.
Mm-hmm.
And I just got tired of it. And I'm kind of giving up, but in a positive way. I'm giving up and saying, here, look, this is the way I am. This is the way I have been. I'm tired.
Did lockdown give you an opportunity to maybe reassess?
Well, lockdown came at the perfect time for me anyway, because I had just started. And I did take the medication, and I still take the medication, and I don't care what anybody says.
Nothing to do
with them. I just take it. And it took about 2.5 months for it to kick in. And that has been the game changer for me.
But what were those 2.5 months like?
They were horrendous.
That's a long time to have to wait for something.
Like you're waiting for a check to come. That you've won the lotto.
Yeah.
And you're kind of like, oh, is it here today? Is it here? And so you're taking this wee tablet and you think, oh. And at times, because it's the chemical change is going on within you, at times I felt worse. And I said, there's a guy that took me under his wing and looks after me, you know, and has been a game changer for me as well. And he said, just keep going. He said, you'll wake up one day and the whole thing had changed. And that's what happened. It was a Saturday morning, and I woke up, and there was no flashing lights, there was nothing, there was no big thing, there was just this, this is different.
Okay.
And I walked into the town, and, you know, I was telling you about it. The greatest thing that's also come into my life is my wee dog, Molly. Because this guy that I go to, because I got to know him for these 2 or 3 months, and I was going to him every week, sometimes twice a week, and he hung on to me. Sometimes people, you just need people to hang on to you, you know, to say, look, here, stay there, it's going to be all right, because I didn't think it was ever going to be all right. I didn't think I would ever be sitting here saying, hey, Bob, this is the way I am, or Jared, this is the way I am, or saying, you know, having it recorded and saying, well... whereas now I can't wait to get it out and say, look, if there's, you know, if this saves one girl or fella or man or woman, you know, that says, oh, God, that's the way I feel. I felt like that, you know.
And you know how alone, you know what a lonely place that is.
Loneliness is the modern day cancer.
Yeah. I think the fact that you that someone like you, who to all of us as a performer,
yeah,
you know, is the life and soul of the party,
yeah,
is brave enough and now feeling strong enough to yeah. say, this was me.
The loneliness, there's a great thing. I read a book by Anthony DeMello called Awareness, and he said a great line. He says, the loneliness that some human beings suffer is not cured by human company.
Hence okay. Molly.
Yeah. Hence the dog, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So the guy that I go to he said to me, you know, he said, you're taking your medication, it's going to kick in, you're coming to me twice a week and we're working through stuff, it's great. He says, now I want you to get a pup. And I just put my head down. I said, oh, holy God. I can't get out of bed. I can't tie my shoelaces. I can't, you know, go days and days where I couldn't make anything to eat. And he wants me to get a pup. And he says, well, is it? That's the next part of your therapy. And lo and behold, 3 weeks later, this ball of fluff came into my life. and he said to me, he says, look, you have a big problem. He says, you don't trust human beings. And he says, you know, and he says, so start with a pup.
Mm-hmm.
And she has been a game changer, you know, the greatest teacher and guru and spiritual book and philosophy mm-hmm. book and this
unconditional love.
Yeah, and she has started to awaken something in me that no human has ever been able to do,
yeah.
or anything that divine has been able to do.
Yes, okay.
You know that this wee thing that I'm responsible for.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's probably that's your reason to get up.
You know, I have to feed her. I mm-hmm. have to walk her. She doesn't. You know, no point in saying to Molly, oh, you know, I'm a bit sensitive today and I'm bulimic and I'm an alcoholic and I haven't much hair either and all this here and I've no money and I've all this here. You know, she you know, she's going to say, I want to play with the ball and go for a walk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Let's go for it. And she's taught me how to play.
And as you and I said, Joe, before in the conversation before this, the divine comes in many forms, doesn't it?
Mm.
And the church's big mistake is that they think they've gone on the market and they're not even close. And for you, that life force that is Molly.
Like
is
I've always had an interest in the spiritual and the divine.
Yeah.
You know, I'm fascinated by it. I really am. As Mr. Maguire will tell you, I've been fascinated for a long, long time since I got sober.
Okay.
35 years. You know, it's like what is it? You know.
Mm-hmm.
There's some reason to this thing.
Yeah.
And this wee ball of fluff, I couldn't figure out. I just couldn't figure it out. And I would actually break down. Mm. I would break down, you know, I'd be with her and she'd come up and she would just lie on my knee and, or she would just look at me. She'd come up, she puts her forehead on my forehead.
Oh.
And she'd just do this here to her and all.
Do it to and, Bob.
No, you're okay. I'm a Yorkshireman.
Ball of Bob. That's his new name.
It's a long time since I've been called
a Ball of Fluffy Bob. Fluffy Bob. That's your new nickname.
Sorry, I couldn't resist.
Oh, all right.
Thanks for that, Janet.
But Mr. Maguire, he's there. So, I couldn't figure her out. And so she was breaking me down.
Oh.
She was breaking me down despite myself. Because nobody was going to break me down, you know. Mm-hmm. So many things that would have broke other people down. I have some kind of resilience, you know. But this wee thing, I have no resilience. And really, what it is love.
Yeah. And she's breaking you down in your relationship with this wee ball of fluff to build you up again. And,
yeah.
And you have said you have learned so much from watching this animal.
Oh,
live and interact with other human beings. And
yeah.
I loved what you were saying, you know, if they were, you know, he's not really entertaining me at the minute, that's fine, next.
Yeah.
you don't have to pander.
No, absolutely. And you know, she is this just kind of wee love machine. You know what I was saying to you yesterday, that it used to be when I go down the town, I don't know, it was great kind of for my ego. Well, Joe, you know, where he's playing this, you know, mm-hmm. so there's an air of entitlement, I suppose, to that there. I go down the town now and it's, well, Molly, well, Joe, you know, it's like I'm an attachment to Molly now, because the whole town knows her.
Yeah.
And which is great. And because, like, I'm kind of interacting with people at a more honest level. I'm not Joe Culby the singer. Joe Culby the singer, singing is just something I do.
Yeah.
It's not going to save lives.
Yeah.
In the food chain, you know, I think musicians, we've got to get, you know, waking up here. You know, what use were a lot of musicians and singers? Maybe okay for collecting money or doing gigs. You know, that's great and we can do so. But like during the pandemic, you know, I remember Mr. Maguire saying to me one time about writing songs, you know, he says, none of these songs are going to save the world or change the world, you know.
No, but it's a release, you know, music is a release.
Oh, it is.
But when
you have it, when it's in its wrong place.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Yeah. When it is this great, joyous thing, it's a, you know, a lot of bands that I played and there was no joy.
Yeah.
There was just no joy. It was grind, you know what I mean? And we either hated the music or we hated the singer or, you know, the lead singer. Or maybe boys hated me. Molly's making me relate to my priorities have changed.
Yeah.
To the point now where I can say, singing is just something that I can do.
Yes.
You know, I can't. I can't change an engine in a car, but I can sing. I can learn a song and I can sing. I can hold a note. I'm no Pavarotti. But for what I have,
yeah,
you know, I can sing a song. And,
and it doesn't define you, and you're not trying to define yourself through it.
You see, if I made a mistake, Jared, I don't know if I made a mistake, I was a mistake.
Okay.
So that's where another part of performance became a torture.
Yeah.
That I I'd be destroyed.
So reaching your rock bottom in the kitchen, realizing the gigs in 2012, and knowing things are going to have to change. The last 10 years, you've obviously worked hard, and you said when we had chatted earlier that now you live in the moment, and you've never been happier or more content.
No,
because you're in the moment.
Yeah. And it's because that's where life is.
That is fantastic.
You know, because again, another thing that I got caught up on was guilt of the past and fear of the future. And it sounds so, you know, you have all these books now of Eckhart Tolle and Wayne Dyer and all these boys and Muji and all these, you know, live in the moment, all the now.
Mm-hmm.
It's all well and good, but can you do it?
Yeah.
You know, will your woundedness let you stay away from the past and let go of it?
Yeah.
And will your fear let you let go of the future and say, well, look, it's going to be all right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I have enough confidence in life and you know, because I felt so lonely and on my own, I thought, well, everything's down to me.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing I really have to do is walk Molly.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Sure, I mean, this is and has been a fascinating and very brave conversation, and one
hugely.
I think is going to resonate with an awful lot of people. So will you come back and do some more for us?
No.
Joe, no. I wanted to say congratulations on being 35 years sober.
Oh, thank
because
you.
That's a huge journey.
It's a lot of help.
And.
It's a lot of help in a day at a time.
Yes. And, you know, there's a lot of people will have listened to you and will probably listen to you again. And there's help out there.
There's loads of help. And you see, the thing is that, again, you know, a lot of people think that asking for help is a sign of weakness.
Absolutely
it's a sign of strength.
Not. Yeah.
The same way that tears, I remember a lovely man saying to me, tears are a sign of strength.
Yes.
So it's that kind of thing that all the things that I, a lot of information that I was given was wrong.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so that's been reversed now. Yeah. And so.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic. And you're going to sing for us.
I am indeed.
You're going to sing This Time, The Dream's on Me.
That's me.
And we're delighted. And thank you so much for coming on the Culture Show. And he will come back,
thank you
know,
Joe.
Bob.
Thank you.
Thanks for asking me. And
pleasure.
For Michael, it's good to see Michael too.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Here's Joe with This Time the Dream's on Me.
Somewhere, someday, we'll be close together, wait and see. Oh, by the way, this time the dream's on me. You take my hand and you look at me adoringly. But as things stand, this time the dream's on me. It would be fun to be certain that I'm the one, to know it, I at least supply the shoulder you cry upon to see you through, till you're everything you wanna be. It can't be true, this time the dream's on me. Fluffy ball. The shoulder you cry upon to see it through, till you're everything you wanna be. It can't be true, this time the dream's on me.
Thank you very much, Joe. Lovely to hear you singing. That was lovely. We're going to do this song for Joe Culby. It's called Where Is the Love? You told me that you didn't love him and you were gonna say goodbye. But if you really didn't mean it, why did you have to lie? Where is the love you said was mine, oh mine, till the end of time? Was it just a lie? Where is the love? If you had had a sudden change of heart, I wish that you would tell me so. Don't leave me hanging on to promises. You've got to let me know.
If you had had a sudden change of heart, I wish that you would tell me so. Don't leave me hanging on to promises. You've got to let me know. It must have been my fate to fall in love with someone else's love. All I can do is wait. Where is the love? Where is the love? Where is the love? Where is the love?
Almost coming to the end of the culture show. We have two more numbers, and this is another wee gem found by the wonderful Paul Maguire, and it's called Honeysuckle Rose.
Every honeybee fills with jealousy when they see you out with me. Goodness knows you're my honeysuckle rose. When you're passing by, flowers droop and sigh, and I know the reason why. Goodness knows you're my honeysuckle rose. Don't buy sugar, you've just got to touch my cup. You're my sugar, it's sweeter when you stir it up. When I'm taking sips from your tasty lips, seems the honey fairly drips. Goodness knows you're my honeysuckle rose. Jealousy when they see you out with me. Goodness knows you're my honeysuckle rose. When you're passing by, flowers droop and sigh, and I know the reason why. Goodness knows you're my honeysuckle rose. Don't buy sugar, you just have to touch my cup. You're my sugar, it's sweeter when you stir it up. When I'm taking sips from your tasty lips, seems the honey fairly drips. Goodness knows you're my honeysuckle rose. Goodness knows you're my honeysuckle rose. Goodness knows you're my honeysuckle rose.
Thank you so much for joining us. thank you to our guests, to Cathy O'Donnell and to Joe Culby, of course. Lovely to have Michael McGinty with us. Thank you, Michael. And, of course, the wonderful Michael Keelty. We're covered by Michaels. Michael Keelty's been doing the sound and vision for us. We are going to finish off this Cultures show now with The More I See You. The more I see you, the more I want you. Somehow this feeling just grows and grows. With every sigh, I become more mad about you, more lost without you, and so it goes.
The more I see you.